Hi there, I'm Matt with Q15T, and we're going to talk about using Confluence databases in the very best way possible. Now, this is a blog post with very important details about an upcoming conference your organization is holding. It's a really great spot for event planners to let everybody in the organization know how everything is going. But it's also really essential that this has the most up-to-date information right here in this blog post, and that's because everybody's going to be reading this blog post to get all of their insights for the entire event, you know, like for like important decision making. This is all well and good as long as none of this really important information changes. Ever. Look, there are always situations where 10 minutes after a blog post just like this is published, an event speaker makes a change, because event speakers are total divas, or maybe a new sponsor signs on. In any cases like this, it's really important that the content of this blog is updated as soon as possible. Well, if this blog post just contained bulleted lists or tables, someone from the events team would have to go in and manually update this blog every time one of those changes happens. Yuck. My friends, this is where Confluence databases come in. With databases, you can share just the information that really matters in whatever context, like the speakers highlighting their headshots or the sessions highlighting the important timing information. And with databases, all of this information is always kept up to date. That's one of its secret powers. And the thing is, we all work with small interrelated pieces of information like this. Whether you plan events or manage projects, maintain directories, manage content production, or even organize important contacts, we are all trying to keep all this information connected and share it and understand what it all means in context. So let's explore the very best ways to use Confluence databases to supercharge and share your important interrelated information. When you first get started with Confluence databases, they can seem a bit overwhelming because there are a lot of options and you can fill up a database very quickly with a bunch of information. But the best thing to do is to start as simply as possible by creating a very basic database to both test the functionality, make sure it works the way you want, and also test to see if it works for the process that you're trying to bring into a database to actually, you know, make it useful. So only make a simple database and then only put the most valuable data into it initially so that you can test it out. So this would be great if maybe you have a process that exists already that the team is familiar with, or a case where maybe the team is already working with a list or a table or a notepad where you jot things down that you can very quickly turn into a database. Along the same lines of simplicity is make sure you give the database a great name. People need to be able to look at it in the content tree or when they search and know what is actually in the database. Also, don't include the word database at the end of the name of the database because it's clear the database is a database. Simple. Now, one of the reasons why you don't want to make a big database and then fill it full of data is that anytime you make a change to one of the field types in the database, it will actually clear all the data out of that column. So you want to start with a simple database with a little bit of data so that if you do need to make those changes to the field types to improve it for your team's process, you're not having to go back and repopulate thousands of entries in your database, just maybe like tens of entries. Then once you have the database at a point where you feel like it's very robust and it's working well for your team's process, then you could go ahead and add all of your data to the database, get the whole team using it. You might even want to lock the structure of the database because you've kind of got it just right. So the goal of a database is to make sure your team can find all of the information they're looking for. And this is done by making sure the database has all the content for whatever context those teammates are working in. So don't be afraid to make a rather large database with lots of columns to make sure it has all the information people need, like links to content pages in Confluence, or summaries, or dates, or content status tag fields. All of the information can be there and you can use database views to filter that all down to just show people what they're actually looking for. But don't steer away from things because you're afraid of making something that's too big. We're not working with a table here. We're working with a database, and we can control what it is our teammates actually see. Another common technique that we often use when we're working with tables that doesn't really make sense with databases is duplicating content. Like if you have a speaker's name in the session table and that same speaker's name in the dietary preferences table. What if you find out there's a typo? Well, then you have to go to both tables and update that name. With databases, you can use database linking fields to have that name in just one database and then link your other databases to that database. So when you do correct that typo, it's corrected across all of them. Also, using multiple databases that are linked together instead of just one giant one also can make making updates and working with those databases a lot easier. Like initially, the content team at K15T had a single database where we managed all the types of content we might create and where it is in the content creation process. And we found that to be pretty unmanageable. So instead, we broke it into separate databases for each type of content and then linked them together on one sort of motherboard database where we can see which types of content we're working on and where that is in the process. And we can work with each individual database separately. It's so much better. Well, we do want to include all the useful information in our database or databases. We also can do some things to make it simple to work with these databases. They're meant to hold all the information we need, but we can also make it easy to maintain, edit, and view those databases. So first, many times when we create a new entry in a database, we also want it to be linked to a Confluence page. So when you create a Confluence page link field, you can have it automatically create a new page and use a specific page template for that page, which you generally want to do. Check out our video all about page templates and why they're so important. This way, your teammates can just type in the name of the new page they want to create, and it will both create the page and automatically connect it to the database so that everybody can just get going quickly. Another thing you can do to simplify using your databases is keep in mind how you set up your different field types. So for example, you can add default values for many fields. This is helpful when there's a common priority in a tag field, for example, or there's a common person that an entry is assigned to. So you could at mention that user as the default value. These can be changed, of course, but it helps simplify entry and make it faster. Also, you should consider whether people should be able to select or add multiple values in a field, like for example, a tag field. Sometimes it doesn't make sense for that and they should only be able to pick one, but there can be situations where multiple actually make sense. Additionally, on a tag field, think about whether people should be able to add new tag entries or they should only be able to pick from the ones that you set up in the field. Again, think about your team and the process. Will it constrict them by not being able to add a new tag in that particular field? Or is that just what the team needs to keep the process orderly? Another thing to keep in mind on text fields is to think about whether or not they should have line breaks or not. Sometimes you want to have a single line text field because it will only have a little bit of text in it. But in other situations, like maybe where you add a summary field, you should enable support for line breaks so people can have a very large piece of text there if that's what your team needs. And of course, you should always add a field description for every field that you add. Even when you're just testing your database, these are really important for accessibility as well as to enable all of your teammates to understand what a field is for. In fact, you should use the description to describe what the field is for. So there is inline help right there. So anybody could hover over a heading and understand what they should actually put in the field. As I mentioned before, views are a really important part of using databases in the best way possible. Because yes, while you want to have all of the information in your database, you want to use views to constrict what is actually shown so that people see the information that's actually useful to them, given whatever context they're in. So a database view is intended really to answer a question someone might have. So the question might be, What do the speakers look like who will be at the event? You can create a view to answer that specific question. And if you are creating a view that shows speakers and their headshots, consider naming the view in that way. Give the view a name that indicates what question it answers, like speakers with headshots. Additionally, you should consider hiding the fields that you're using for filtering on your view. So for example, in this view, I am filtering and only showing the sessions for the GoodCon 24 conference. So it's implied by the name of the view here that I'm only looking at GoodCon 24 sessions, so I can hide the conference field altogether because no one needs to see the conference these are for because they already know what conference it is. Finally, do not over-engineer your team's process to make databases work. They can do a lot. I know it. I really enjoy coming up with creative solutions for databases, but as you begin testing and improving your databases and adding more data, constantly communicate with your team to see if those databases are actually working for them and if the process is working for the team. We have a few processes that we've built around databases that we've actually needed to rework or rebuild at K15T because they haven't really met a team's process, or maybe the team's needs have changed, and so we've had to rebuild our databases to match that change. Always start simple and move toward more complex only when it adds value, and always assess whether or not the tool actually matches the needs that the team has. Databases often will, but every once in a while, maybe you need a different solution, maybe a simpler solution, maybe a more complex one. Always be having those conversations because a database is here to answer questions and not just create more questions. And this, my friends, is the best way to use Confluence databases. At K15T, not only did we come up with Confluence databases, but also we run all of our internal processes using databases. We are constantly pursuing new use cases for this really powerful part of Confluence, and we are always looking to share those. So check out our playlist of database use cases that we've discovered so far, and we will continue to add those as we discover. And of course, this is just databases. There is so much more you can do in Confluence, and at K15T, we will explore each of those in an orderly fashion. So share this video with a teammate looking to share their important interrelated information, hit those like and subscribe buttons, and of course, join us for another video as we continue to explore how to use Confluence to share what you do best.